chapter 1 of the Gospel by Mark. I called it a treasure hunt. Did you notice I said that? Did you know that every time we open the Bible, we walk over what for most of us is familiar ground, and we're walking through the greatest treasures imaginable, and often we don't see them. Now, I thought about that this week. Did you catch the news that stunned the archaeological world? Nicholas Reeves, a British archaeologist that serves, I don't know, Emory or somewhere at some American institution, was examining high-res photographs of the walls of King Tutankhamun's tomb. I mean, wouldn't you like a job like that, to be examining photographs of Egyptian tombs? I mean, and be paid massively to do it. And he was doing that, and all of a sudden he published, actually last year, a proposition. I got it first in the, you know, I get the feed on the archaeology stuff, the papers that are posted, and it came through. It was very interesting. It says he proposed that what everyone agrees, King Tut's tomb is not a male tomb. It's a female tomb. It's a queen's tomb. It's not shaped, cut into the rock the way that all the other king's tombs look in Egypt in the Valley of the Kings. It's cut the way all the queen's tombs look. Everybody knows that, right? You all know that. Well, he was examining the walls, and he said, I believe King Tut was placed in his mother's tomb, Queen Nefertiti's tomb. And I believe there's more there. And this week, I mean, he proposed that last year. This week, the Japanese brought their really fancy through stone x-ray, portable x-ray machine, and they ran it around that tomb, and guess what they found? There are two passageways leading off that have always been there for 3,430 years. Those doorways are painted right into the pretty walls. And old Nicholas Reeves, examining those photographs, saw an exact clear outline of a door. Two. And now the world is stunned because it's been confirmed, the Japanese say, that there's organic material 50 feet underground in solid rock. Organic material? That means it grew on the surface and someone put it there behind that wall. That's wood or something. And there's metal. And you know what metal you find in the Valley of the Kings? Gold, right? So everybody's just amazed at the buried treasure. That same wonder is what we should have when we open this book. Because this book's been around longer than 3,430 years, and it's just as often the treasures overlooked as King Tut's tomb. Well, this morning, missing hidden treasures in familiar places is what we're looking at. And as we go into chapter 1 of the Gospel by Mark, notice what the very first word says. It's the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. The gospel is the good news that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He is the Savior of the world. He did come to solve our deepest problem, which is our sin. Our sin is the center, the root of problems. I was having a discussion with someone this week, and they were talking about going through one of our parks in town. They said, it's horrible. People just throw trash down and everything else. And they said, you're probably going to tell me that's because of sin. And I said, it is. Our deepest problems, the things we do that we wish we didn't do, the things we do that make us feel horrible, the things that we say that we wish we could take back, and everything else that causes us guilt and despair and depression and discouragement and feeling empty and worthless, all stems from sin. I mean, I was looking this week at these 60-year-old men that are being, because, you know, we have that fraud alert on our credit card, and every time a sexual predator moves within 5 miles of us or something, they send their picture and their bio. I mean, how would you like to have your picture sent out and your bio sent out and your address sent out because you are struggling with this insatiable, sinful desire that you probably hate and wish you didn't have? You see, that's what sin does. And that's why Jesus came. And the treasure of treasure is finding who he was in this book. And this morning, I'm going to show you, actually, this is what I did this week. I took an examination from cover to cover of the Gospel by Mark, and I found everything that Jesus said about himself. That's his self-revelation. Then I looked at everything that he did. And then I looked at what the people that were close to him that actually witnessed Jesus, what they said, kind of like comments that the hidden mic or the live mic picks up. The exact words of what they said about Jesus, which we would call his reputation, what others said about him. And those three combined are the treasure that sits always right in front of us in this book. You know, in American history, I have to tell you this because remember I was a history major. I'll try and not tell any more historic stories, but do you all know about this event right here? The Comstock Lode? How many of you ever heard of the Comstock Lode? Come on. Okay, a few of you, the ones that were awake during American history class. 1859, two miners, O'Reilly and McLaughlin, two men looking for gold, struck gold in 1859 at the head of 6 Mile Canyon in Nevada. I mean, that's just right out of the history books. And it was encased in quartz, and they pounded away with their pickaxes and found a little tiny bit, ran down to the office, had it assayed, and staked their claim on that little piece of ground. Well, they sold their gold, bought, which all good miners would do back then, sold their gold, bought alcohol, got totally smashed, and Henry Comstock was leaning up at the bar next to them and convinced them in their total inebriation that that document they were holding was actually his claim deed, not theirs. And they gullibly walked down to the office and signed it over to Mr. Comstock, who was quite sober, and he got the gold claim. Well, that's, you know, all that did is ensure his name got in history, but that wasn't the Comstock Lode. If you read history, it says, multitudes of treasure-seeking miners, lured by the sound of gold fever, began to follow the vein of gold up the canyon. They spent every day slogging their way up and down the narrow 6 Mile Canyon. But what history records is, it wasn't the gold they found. It was the fact that every day it got harder and harder to get to the mining area because their feet slowly got encased in a strange bluish-gray cement that stuck to everything. It cased their pickaxes. It covered their shovels till they were too heavy to lift. It covered the wagon wheels until the animals could not pull the wagons up the canyon. And it covered their boots so that they felt like they were wearing lead. And that's how it went month after month as tiny bits of gold were found here and there. A new miner came, went to work, walked in the mud, said, "This is strange," turned around and walked with his boots on to the assayer's office, kicked up his boot, scraped some off, and handed it to the assayer and said, "What is that stuff?" It was the highest grade silver ore ever found on the surface of the earth. It turned out to be, that's what the Comstock Lode was. It wasn't gold, it was silver. It was so rich, every single shovelful that you stuck in the ground was worth a dollar in 1859. How many shovels can you do? I mean, can you imagine? There was $400 million worth of silver in 1859 on top of the ground. Did you know in today's dollars, every shovel would have been worth $100? Now, I would join the ditch digging club for $100 a shovel. Can you imagine? You just go as fast as you can. That's where the Crocker Bank fortune, the William Randolph Hearst fortune, California's riches started flowing into California through the Comstock Lode. Now, why do I like history? Because the common thread is in each of those stories, whether it's Nicholas Reeves looking at pictures everyone has seen, whether it's slogging up through the same canyon, never wondering why your feet were heavy. It's the same truth for us. Did you know what we should do? We often, I know this happens because I listen to people. I think sometimes people, I'm too far away, they don't know that I'm walking in the hallways with them. They go, "We were in the same chapter again this week." And you know what I think about when I see them? They're walking and their feet are heavy and they're walking over the greatest treasure and they just need to stop and look and find Christ in every part of the Bible. Did you know we could cover like one pastor did, John 3:16, every Sunday for 2 years, he did that and never exhausted. If you stop, look, and find Christ. So how do we do that? Well, let's do that this morning, because the treasure is knowing God through Christ is eternal life. And so I'm going to take you on my little Bible study. I'm going to do it very rapidly. How do you find treasures in Christ's actions? We look all the way through the book at what he did, okay? So first of all, look at chapter 1 with me in verse 25. Here's the first thing, and I'm just doing these in the order that they show up, of what Jesus did. In chapter 1, in verse 25, it starts in verse 21, he's in the synagogue, he's teaching in verse 22, there's an attender in verse 23 of chapter 1 of Mark's gospel who happened to be filled with an unclean spirit, and the man in the middle of the service starts crying out. The word kradzo means screaming at the top of his voice. Boy, wouldn't that wake up the service? I mean, those people had sat in synagogue services all their lives. And all of a sudden, while Jesus, the itinerant visiting rabbi, is speaking the word, one of the locals, one of the regulars, starts bulging eyes, looking at the front at Jesus and screaming as he looked at Jesus. Now, that would be an attention getter. Kind of sounds like a political rally nowadays, right? If you've been watching the news. And so, if you continue reading, verse 24, he's saying something. He's looking at Jesus and just bugging out his eyes, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are. You are the Holy One of God." And Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be quiet and come out of him." And when the unclean spirit had convulsed him, now, this is a show. Can you imagine those staid, placid, quiet Jews watching this screamer with the buggy eyes all of a sudden fall to the ground, roll around, writhing violently, convulsing, jerking, and then this spirit, something that was disembodied from him, screamingly leaves him. I mean, what an amazing thing. And they were all amazed, verse 27. Let me ask you, who is it that can command demons? Anyone. Seven sons of Sceva did it in Acts 19. They went around and said, "We implore you, be out, you know, you demons." Anybody can do that. People have always done that. But who is it that demons obey? Who is it that scares the life out of those demons, that causes them to scream and fear and just be overwhelmed when they see that person? See, demons are not omniscient nor omnipresent. And that demon had lived inside that man in that synagogue for a long time, and that demon and that man had come to that synagogue a long time, and a lot of people had droned on about who knows what in that synagogue. But all of a sudden, as that man and that demon were sitting in that synagogue, that demon stopped bothering the man long enough to look up to see the speaker, and he looked into the very face of God, and it scared him to death. See, who is this that demons obey? How about this? Look at verse 31. It starts in 29. As soon as they come out of that amazing service in the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon, which means it was very close to the synagogue. And if you go to Israel, it really is. You can still see Simon's house. It's there. And with James and John, but they didn't have dinner ready, verse 30, because Simon's wife's mother lay sick with a fever. And they told him about her at once, and they said, "Sorry, we brought you over for Sunday dinner. Actually, it was Saturday dinner after the synagogue, but there's no meal because Peter said my mother-in-law is sick. And of course, my wife doesn't know how to cook, and I don't either, so we're in trouble," you know, or whatever. I don't know what happened, but it was a big problem. And look what Jesus did in verse 31. He came and took her by the hand, lifted her up, and immediately the fever left her, and she served them. Now, you know what? Jesus commanded the sickness Did you know our town is built around commanding sickness, right? What do we have here? We have pharmacy up, John, Pfizer, you know what I mean? We, if you take the right pills and the right amount and have the right disease and do everything right, it will affect certain diseases, right? Jesus commanded sickness and it obeyed. Who can do that? Only the one who was who he said he was. I have come that you might have life and have it more abundant. The thief, the devil, comes only to kill and steal and destroy, but I come to give you abundant life. And he was demonstrating who he was to the demons, to the sick people. How about this one? Look in chapter 1 at the end. This guy starts in verse 40, a leper. Now, you know what the thing is about demons? You can't see them. I mean, that guy was foaming and writhing, but we didn't see anything. The thing about fevers, you don't see it. You see the effects, you know, red, you know, heat, but you don't see it. Leprosy, you can see. I mean, it was the most dreaded condition of the ancient world. It actually, Hansen's disease is actually a neurological disorder where you lose feeling in areas of your life, and there's areas of your body. And so, like, if it starts in your feet, you don't feel your feet anymore. And you know how we stub our toe and we go, whoa, you know, and you favor it, you know, and everyone, you soak it and you wrap it and you're caring for it, you know, and you get that torn, fingernail or toenail and you just guard it and you turn your ankle and boy, we get all the crutches and we get everything and the walkers and we are... They didn't feel any of that. So they would walk on their turned ankle until their foot broke off and they were walking on their stub and they didn't feel a thing. Infection got in, thorns, rocks. They actually would wear parts of their body off because they didn't feel. You know, we get a little blister and we just, you know, we tell everybody about it. But Hansen's leprosy, the body slowly is eaten away by infection, by decay, because there's no feeling. There's a loss of any sensation of pain for heat, puncture, scrape, anything. So these people, I mean, the pictures, they don't have noses, they don't have ears. A lot of them, you see their jaw. You can see right in their mouth. You can see their tongue all the time. They look like walking skeletons, and they smelled like death because the tissue was oozing and dying. So that one you can see. And this person like that, excluded from culture and civilization, living usually out in the tombs or wherever they could find, hidden away because they would be shooed out of public, sees Jesus coming in verse 40 and comes to Jesus and implores him and kneels down to him and says to him, "Whoever you are, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Then Jesus, moved with compassion. Remember, that's the most frequently mentioned emotion of Jesus Christ. And he didn't just have it. He was moved with compassion, splanknoi. It was visceral. I mean, when he saw people, he didn't just think it. He went, He could feel compassion for them. Now look at the next part of verse 41. Stretched out his hand. Now, that must have horrified. I mean, they've already gone through the screaming man in the synagogue and all that, but the teacher from the synagogue is moving his hand toward, doesn't he know he will become defiled? He will become unclean. We cannot be around him. He cannot be around us. He's going to become unclean if he touches that leper. I mean, can you imagine the thoughts that are running through his disciples' minds and everybody that's anywhere near? And Jesus is stretching out his hand and touched him, and instantly, according to Jewish law, Jesus became unclean by touching an unclean person that had leprosy. And look what he says, and he said to him, "I am willing." You wondered if I'm willing? You came to me, you want to be cleansed, you want me to cleanse you. Do you think I want to do that? You bet I want to do that. And Jesus reached out to him, horrifying the crowd, and touched him and said, "I'm willing, be cleansed." Now look at verse 42. See, this is, remember, the Gospel by Mark is actually the Gospel of Peter written down by Mark, because it's Peter's recollections. Mark was there. It's Peter. I mean, we're just coming from Peter's mother-in-law's dinner, and we're now with, and Peter's the kind of guy, I mean, have you ever had something happen like at the supermarket and there's a crowd and someone comes right through the crowd and comes right to the front and looks? That's Peter. I mean, he was all over everything, just had no sense of decorum. He just was in the front of everything. And look at how he saw this happen. And as soon as he had spoken, immediately the leprosy left him. I mean, he's redundantly reminding us, as soon as he spoke, immediately. Now let me ask you, who can look at someone whose body is rotting and talk and the rot flees? Do you know what the Bible says? That their skin became as new as at the beginning. I mean, that's better than oil of Olay. Can you imagine having baby skin when yours had rotted and worn off? And amazing. Do you know why Jesus did this? I mean, it's a picture of salvation. When I come to the point that I am burdened by my sin, I was thinking this week, you know, when we were in Rome, when I was speaking there, someone on the subway stole my wallet, which I had in my front pocket, like, you know, Rick Steves said you're supposed to, and I still got stolen. No, it wasn't my wallet, it was my iPhone, which is my wallet. And so we had to cancel everything, you know what, and it was terrible. But then we bought that credit, you know, protect, you know, your identity thing. And so do you know what I get from that? I've never had anybody steal anything again. Do you know what I get? Every time a sexual predator moves in, I get informed of it. I always think of those people racked by their sin when I see Jesus reaching out. You see, Jesus wants us, if we will say, I am filthy, dirty, guilty sinner, and ask him to cleanse us, his first response is visceral. He is moved with compassion, comes toward us, reaches out, and actually takes our sin onto himself. He absorbs it. In 1962, kneeling with my mother, Jesus absorbed a lifetime of sin. All my sin from 56 to 62, all my sins from 62 to 2016, and to the last moment I live. And all of that was placed on him. And he hung in front of God, who, and now I'm getting into Friday night's message, but you don't have to come if you don't want to. And God put all of his angry wrath upon my sin and treated Jesus hanging on the cross like he committed my sin. Do you know that's why I can share the gospel with anyone? I mean, I've been thinking about taking that list from LifeLock or wherever I get it from and knocking on the door. I just got a printout about you. I have your address. Are you a predator? Can you imagine that? And look them in the eye and say, how would you like to have all the guilt and all the agony and all the filthiness you feel labeled like that, wearing your little foot, you know, bracelet thing to monitor where you are at all times so you don't get too close to any school, you know? How would you like to know the peace of God that passes understanding? Because Jesus can command the leprosy of your sin and it will flee instantly. Do you know what that does? That's why it's fun to lead people to Christ. Have you ever led anybody to Christ? It's a joy to see the burden of their sin gone. And they're a new creation in an old body. They have a new creation. Well, Jesus didn't stop there. He keeps going. Look at verse 5 of chapter 2. Jesus can also forgive sins, he can forgive any sin, by the way, it says in chapter 3, verse 28. In Mark 2, 8, I mean, this is bad. How would you like someone that can see and explain your thoughts? These people are sitting around watching Jesus perform. Well, first of all, the guy comes through the ceiling and is lowered, and Jesus said, I forgive your sins. And all the people around are thinking, he can't forgive sins. What is he? He's making a false claim. He cannot forgive sins. And Jesus looked him right in the eye and says, were you thinking I can't forgive sins? I could tell you were thinking that. I can. How would you like to be around someone that can see what you're thinking, and as you're thinking, discuss it with you out loud? You know what you'd do? You'd go, ugh, I'm not going to think anything when I'm around him. I don't want him to see it. Do you understand? Who can do that? That's what this whole book is about. That's the treasure. Who can do all these things? There's only one person that can do all this stuff. By the way, did you know that the Sadducees and Pharisees never accused Jesus of not doing all this? I mean, they could have crucified him for claiming to heal leprous people, and they'd bring the leper and he was still leprous. Or claiming to raise the dead and bringing the body and say they're still dead. Or claiming that he made a blind man and showing he's still blind. No. All these people, it really happened. And the people that hated Jesus and crucified him never said he didn't do all this. They just said he did it in Satan's power, not God's, which was the unpardonable sin. Well, he also can remove physical paralysis. The guy that was let down, Jesus spoke, and he was unparalyzed. Did you know what he does in chapter 4? He talks to the wind. Now, I've talked to the wind. You know, I've been carrying stuff, and it blew out of my arms and went, oh, I wish it wasn't blowing so hard. And it didn't stop. Jesus talks to the wind and the waves, and they respond. Who can do that? I mean, the next one, look at chapter 6. Look at this one. He instantly calmed the storm. And what I love about it, if you look at chapter 6, verse 51, it's not so much the calming of the storm, it's the stirring up of the disciples that got me. He said, in verse 51, he went up into the boat to them, and the wind ceased, and they were greatly amazed in themselves beyond measure and marveled, for they couldn't understand how a complete 12-mile by 6-mile lake of water could be so turned up. The word in Greek, bassinazo, is like jacuzzied. You ever seen jacuzzi where it's just going like that? You know, it's just totally turned up. And when Jesus stepped into the boat, he instantly calmed it. And they were scared and didn't want to stay in the boat. Who wants to be in a boat with that kind of a person? I mean, what else can they do? See, that's, who was this? He's who he claimed to be. And we go through chapter 9, the Transfiguration. Inside, Jesus was brighter than the sun. He was blindingly, that's what, remember, he began to glow. In chapter 9, 33, he's back to reading people's minds. He communicates direct. I mean, when they were listening to him pray, they'd heard prayers all their life. And they were just overwhelmed that it just seemed like he was talking to God. And that he actually believed that God was his Father and he was his beloved Son. And sometimes God even talked out loud to him, like at his baptism and just before the cross. And he communicated with God like nobody else did. And finally, he chose when to die. Do you remember what happened in the run-up? We'll do this Friday night, but you know, he's in Gethsemane, and he's there, and Jesus is nondescript. That means there was nothing physically that made him stand out. I mean, he wasn't one of those knockout-looking persons. He needed someone to come and kiss him so they knew who he was. He was so nondescript. So the plan was Judas would, in the dark, look around until he found the right person that was Jesus. And when he found him, he was supposed to come and hug and kiss him so that the soldiers would get him. How many did they bring? 600. Because you don't know what to do with this guy who can make the storm stop and feed thousands of people and fix, you know, leprosy. So they were going to be ready if he pulled any fast ones on them. And so Jesus stepped forward after the kiss and said, "Who are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he said, "I am." All 600 of them, flat on their faces. They didn't even know what happened to them. It was the quickest judo move you ever saw. They were flattened. And after he established the control of the situation, he said, "You just need me. You don't need my disciples." And he let them go. You see, he knew the disciples couldn't survive what he was going through. But he chose when to die, when to turn himself over. And on the cross, you know the song, he could have called 10,000 angels, but he didn't. He chose when to die. Well, that's what he did. How about what did people around him say about him? And I'll just run through these. Number one, in Mark 1:7, if you want to turn there, this is the very last Old Testament prophet. He was, according to Jesus, the greatest man born of women up until that moment. So all of humanity until that time, John the Baptist, his cousin, was at the pinnacle of human amazing giftedness. And what did that friend of Jesus, his own cousin, say? Verse 7. He preached saying, there comes one after me who is mightier than I, whose sandal strap I'm not worthy to stoop down. I baptize with water. John says, I'm involved in ceremonies, but he baptizes with the Holy Spirit. He said, he does the supernatural. I can't even undo his sandal. I mean, he is so much greater than me, the greatest human. I can't even get near him. He's that great. That's his reputation. The spirit world. I mean, I read this already. Look at verse 24, chapter 1. I know who you are. You're the Holy One of God. Those spirits that are not bounded by our physical world, that come and go, that are all around the universe, that come in front of the throne of God, that know who God is, they said, you aren't fooling us, hiding out in that human body. We know, as Isaiah said, you're the Holy One of God. What did the terrified fallen angels who had mighty power say in chapter 3, verse 11? It's amazing. It says, and unclean spirits, whenever they saw him, fell down before him and cried out. What is the testimony of the spirit world? God had arrived and was walking around in a human body. That's what they were saying. Whenever they saw him walking, they would scream and cry and writhe and just tell everybody, watch out. God's walking by. Wow. That's his reputation. They also said, don't send us to the pit. He had the power of eternal destruction. I love what it says in Mark 8:29. Peter said this in 8:29. He said to them, but who do you say that I am? And Peter, of course, rushed to the front of the crowd of disciples and said, you're the Christ. You're the sum, the fulfillment of all Old Testament prophecies. So those closest to him said, you're that. And then the angels, they verified that he was immortal. They said, why do you seek the living, the one who is self-existent among the dead? Amazing. And finally, what did Jesus say about himself? His self-descriptions. This is very, very interesting. I mean, if nothing else, Jesus claimed to be our bridegroom. He says, I'm engaged to all of you that love me and know me and have been born into my family, and I'm going to prepare a place for you, and I'm going to come back and take you to myself. He claimed to be above the law and the Sabbath. He says, you guys are living by the law. I'm the one that gave it. I'm the lawgiver. He claimed to be the ultimate and final judge. He says, I'm going to determine your destiny. He said in chapter 9, verse 31, he knows all the future. He knew exactly, precisely the events of the future. He claims to be the master of the universe. He said, I'm the master of the house. I'm the one that you ought to worry about coming home and find you doing what you shouldn't be doing because I'm the master. Doesn't say, the, when the master returns. He claimed to be the only way of eternal salvation. He said, through his blood, forgiveness of sin came. And finally, he claimed he was God the Son at the right hand of the Father, who was King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Knowing him, the Bible says, brings endless life. If you look at those four verses, did you know that every time anybody got near Jesus and actually saw him up close. 122 says they were astonished. 127 says they were amazed. 441 says they feared exceedingly. 651 says they were greatly amazed in themselves beyond measure and marveled. It's just piling up superlatives. Because if you know him, if you respond and just say to him, if you're willing, you can cleanse me, he will say to you, as he said to me, I'm willing. That's why I came. I will give you cleansing and, on top of it, eternal life. Now, see, the Gospel of Mark is like the 6 Mile Canyon. You can walk through it all day long and just be slogging through some of the richest treasure. By the way, the whole Bible's like that. I just did Mark because we only had a half hour to do it. But did you know we can find the treasures of Christ every day? And when we find it, knowing Christ answers, as I've told you repeatedly, the three greatest questions. Number one, where did I come from? And the only verified answer. You know when you go online shopping, you look for the VeriSign? You don't want to give your credit card to those Romanian hackers, you know. You've got to make sure you have a site that has HTTPS, you know, that's secure. What's the only secure site that tells you about your origin? The Bible. The question of where I came from is only answerable when we come face to face with the truth that answers this question, who was he? He claims that he is my creator and yours. So nobody knows us like he does, because he designed us, Psalm 139 says, from the DNA level up. The second question, why am I here? I mean, especially after you've lived two-thirds of your life and are further in debt and tired. I mean, what am I here for? That question is only answerable, our purpose, when we come face to face with the truth that answers the question, what did Jesus do? He came to redeem me from my frail, transient weakness. I can't even stay awake. I have to sleep. I have to go unconscious, totally vulnerable, just to make it, to get enough strength to go through another day. I am not self-existent. He is. And he said, I want to have a little partnership with you. I'll give you a new heart, and I'll put endless life inside of you, if you'll come to know me as your Redeemer. Wow. Who wouldn't want that? Most people don't. Most people don't. And the final question, where am I going? What's at the end of all this? Am I just going back, you know, into the ground? And that question is only answerable when we come face to face with the truth that answers the question. Why did he come? He said it. He's the master of the universe. He said, every human that's ever lived is going to stand right in front of me. And I'm going to ask them whether or not they have their sins, or while they were alive on earth, they asked me to take their sins. That's the, either you have the Son and he's taking your sins away, or you don't have the Son and you're still wearing them. And if you're still wearing them in front of his great white throne, they're like a big chain around you, and you will be cast in the lake of fire and forever be sinking, carried down by your sins into the wrath of God, which he offered to pour out on Christ and take the chains of your sin off. But he'll only do that for those who will call out to him and say, if you're willing, you can make me clean. So the question is, are you going to face that truth now and say, I'm lost and sinful and in need of a Savior? Or then? Did you know everybody's a believer in hell? Everybody will be a believer in hell, but it's too late. Because while you hear his voice, the voice of God among us, who lived a perfect life, who died a substitutionary death, who offers endless life to everybody who will come like that leper and implore Jesus, if you're willing, you can cleanse me. That's who he was. He is God, the Son, the Good Shepherd who gave his life for the sheep, the one who said, I'm come that you might have life, and not just squeak by life, abundant, overflowing life. That's who he was. Let's bow before him in prayer, and as we bow, invite Jeff Whitaker to come up for the closing of our service, and let's pray. Father in heaven, I thank you for the greatest week in the history of the universe. I thank you that this is life eternal, that we can know you, O God, even Jesus Christ, whom you sent. You sent him to die in my place, to become guilty for my sins, to be treated by you, O Father, as if Jesus committed my sins. You put the blame, you put the penalty, you put it all on him. And you give me in return your complete, absolute forgiveness and an abundant, overflowing, guilt-free, filled with joy life. Wow. Why do so few want your great offer? But I pray that today you would stir hearts and draw to yourself someone that's here this morning, and maybe for the first time, they're actually hearing it. And I pray that right where they sit right now, that they would cry out to you like that leper and say, you can make me clean. And may they hear and feel you reach out to them and say, I'm willing, be cleansed. Thank you. Draw to yourself those whom you're calling. Bless us as we go out this week and invite people to hear about what you did on that cross as we gather again Friday night. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.